Hi everyone, I hope you're doing fine and you have a few minutes to spare to engage with my first video, which pertains to the pretty much untold story of Swift on the server. Yet, before I proceed any further, please allow me to introduce myself. I am Javier Sicelli, a co-founder and lead software engineer at Röck+Cöde, your software and marketing partner in Amsterdam, the Netherlands. I'm a career freelance full-stack mobile developer with a penchant for new technologies. I focus on their best usage in various products and services across the industry spectrum to ensure both customer-centered development and end-user satisfaction. But enough about me and my pursuits, time we jump straight to the topic of this video. So, as already announced, today I want to tell you more about a programming language I've been using extensively, Swift. You might already be familiar with this language, but for those of you who hear about it for the first time, in line with popular perception, Swift is used to build mobile applications for Apple devices. Although this statement is correct, it obscures the full picture and it creates the impression that this programming language is just a one-trick pony with limited applications. Given that Swift is defined as a general-purpose language, I would like to go beyond this preconception to tell you about using Swift on the server, or more commonly known, server-side Swift. As a technical arm of my company, I've been building mobile applications for clients for the last decade. From experience, I can tell you that a mobile app without a good data and a proper backend infrastructure is usually nothing more than a gimmick, a waste of digital shelf space, and a one-star product in mobile stores. Personally, I've been on the other side, as I spent part of my professional career as a backend developer before moving into the app frontend. That was a long time ago, right? In a galaxy far, far away. So it's nice to go back and tackle backends from a different perspective using the very same language you are using for building mobile applications. It's like taking the proverbial leap and going beyond your comfort zone to see what other possibilities are out there, right? So let's get ready for some show and tell, because if it's not coded, it did not happen. Okay, so what is what I want to show you, and why is it worth your time and possible research into the technology? Well, I've been building a CMS, or a content management system, as a microservice to manage content across multiple sites, including asset management, support for multiple languages, and interfacing to social media platforms. In a nutshell, this microservice contains all the required CMS business logic, and it offers a nice set of RESTful API endpoints that provide bi-directional communication from and to the outside world. It's really neat, but the question is, will it work? So, as you can see, I am using Vapor, a popular web framework written in Swift that works for both macOS and Ubuntu Linux platforms. The awesome thing about Vapor is that it allows the developer to use Swift and some of its tools outside the mobile app development domain. And just like that, all of a sudden, backend development sounds exciting. For data persistent purposes, I'm using a PostgreSQL database engine, which I connect to the Vapor app by using the Fluent framework and its respective PostgreSQL driver. As you may notice, I'm using a Dockerized instance of PostgreSQL for development, and it just gets better from here. For the actual development bit, I use the latest Xcode IDE release, but if you prefer to use your code editor of choice, such as Visual Studio Code, you can perfectly do so. Now, first thing first, I created some tightly related models, which are recreated as tables in the database engine, and I wrote some field validations in cases where these models are created from an API endpoint. After that, I wrote some migrations to instruct the Fluent driver to create and revert tables in the database out of the defined models and their relationships. Moreover, you can also pre-populate the database table with some data if you require. After that, I implemented the controllers, which contains the business logic of the application, and then, of course, the logical step was to create the routes that matches the functionality of the controller with the respective API endpoints. Finally, I added the migrations to run, and I registered the routes that the application should provide. Okay, that was a nice chunk of development out there. So now we have a Vapor application that provides and receives various data in JSON format, but how do we know if it works as expected? Throughout the whole development, I wrote unit tests, a lot of them. In addition, Vapor provides a test framework called XCT Vapor to use with Apple XCTest framework as well. I know it's difficult, which allows the developers to test API endpoints. So every time I integrated a new route into the application, I ran the test suite to verify and validate the respective implementations. In addition, this process helped me understand how the Vapor framework works even better. It was a great learning exercise, as to kill two birds with one stone. Because of this testing, I realized that the JSON data model I was receiving from the endpoints feature the representation of the models I previously defined in the application. Yet, those data models weren't precisely the same. So, this is a practical tip from the trenches. The secret to good endpoint testing is to populate your database with data that you need to simulate real cases, so you can test both happy and unhappy paths. To avoid unhappy incidents, always clean up the database after each test. Of course, during the development of this application, it dawned on me that some code I wrote could be reused in some other Vapor projects. So I created a new library called Lemmy, which I will release as open source in the nearby future, so anybody can use it in their Vapor projects, of course. But now, where were we? Right. We have a working microservice with a set of APIs endpoint that nobody's consuming right now. So what's next? Well, I decided against creating any kind of classic admin or CMS web interface. Instead, I developed a cross-platform client library that can be consumed by other Vapor applications or by macOS and or iOS applications. You know, in the name of efficiency and because the technology allows it. So, this client is built on top of the async HTTP client dependency, a cross-platform library for networking operations also written in Swift. And basically, this client implements all the available calls from the microservice for every available resource and provides the data transfer objects or DTOs required to use and manipulate the data. Now we have this web client that provides and receives various objects decoded from data in JSON format. But here comes the ever haunting question. How do we know if it works as expected? I took the very same approach I adopted with the microservice testing, and I wrote unit tests throughout the development as well. So every time I implemented a new resource into the client, I ran the test suite to verify and validate implementations on both the service and the client. And as in the curious case of the microservice, during the development of this client, I decided that some code I wrote could be reused in implementation of other API clients. No, so I created yet another library called OSI, which I will release as open source in the nearby future as well, so you can use it on your own clients too. Well, 6 years after the introduction of Swift, this programming language has definitely outgrown the title of a language to build only Apple apps to quickly become a powerful general-purpose language with enough tools to assist with the development of various types of cross-platform software solutions. Moreover, since Apple made Swift open source, the language has been continuously evolving because of the proposals submitted by developers around the world. What I also like about it is that it features a clear, defined roadmap for the nearby future. Swift on the server directly profits from this continuous evolution, and this can be seen in the frameworks and tools that have become available in the last couple of years. Moreover, the exciting news is that the Swift Package Manager is almost ready for prime time. Just wait a few more weeks. In addition, the Xcode IDE allows developers to build not just mobile apps for Apple devices, as frameworks such as Foundation, Dispatch, and XCTest can be used to build cross-platform software. The Vapor framework, well, This is the framework to use for creating cross-platform web, API, and other web server applications, as it is simple to use, packed with features, and ready for scalable deployments with Docker. So you might want to spend some time studying it, as it is an investment that is definitely worth your time. The async HTTP client allows developers to implement full-blown cross-platform web clients out of a simple premise. And finally, whereas Swift developers may not have at their disposal the mature tools and libraries of older languages such as Java, Python, or JavaScript to build server applications, it is just a matter of time before reliable tools and libraries become available. Overall, the potential usage for cross-platform solutions of the Swift programming language appears quite feasible. Then again, for a language with such an ambitious mindset such as Swift, the future is definitely bright. So that was all I wanted to show you and share with you today. I would like to thank each and every one of you for watching this video, and I will be more than happy to continue the discussion about the possibilities the Swift language offers in the comments below. In addition, if you like this video, you are more welcome to like it, love it, share it, you know the drill. So thanks for watching, and until next time.